use this one. Good morning. Welcome to Grove's First Baptist Church. It's good to be here this morning. It's good to be here with you. As we just saw in our videos, today is a big day in our children's ministry. We have our Tournament of the Bible happening tonight at 5 o'clock. And these videos hopefully encapsulate what we're trying to do between Tobias and Lucas, the two boys you saw at the beginning. They're brothers. Tobias is trying to beat Lucas. Lucas is trying to defend his older brother honor and not letting his younger brother win. But even though it's been a competition, you can see in that third video, for the last year, our students, our children have been working on knowing the Bible better, knowing truths about God, knowing theology. And so tonight is an opportunity for them to compete in some fun, but also for you to come and to see what they've learned, to see the hard work they've been putting in. And so they're actually over in the NPR right now, going over some things, kind of practicing and trying to learn these. It is going to be competition. We got some prizes for them tonight for the winners, but then also just some recognition for the hard work they've put in. So I encourage you to be here at 5 o'clock tonight. It'll be in the NPR at 5 o'clock. We'll have their game show, their competition. Then afterwards, we'll have some refreshments, a time of just fellowship together. Also happening in your bulletin, we got a lot of things going on in the next few weeks. Beginning with tomorrow, Monday at 9 a.m., we're going to be decorating the church for Christmas time. And so if you're able and willing to help, please be here at 9 o'clock. After church today, me and some of the youth and young adults, we're going to get all the stuff out of the basement and get it up here so you guys can decorate. So if you're able to, we encourage you to be here. It'll be a fun time together. Happening next Sunday, December 5th, is our adult choir cantata. And again, just like our kids have been working hard, our choir has been working hard. So we encourage you to be here next Sunday for that, to worship the Lord together with them. Also next Sunday in the evening at 5 o'clock is our International Missions Banquet. And we have Chris Robinson, a missionary to Latvia, will be here to be our guest speaker. And so I encourage you to come to hear his testimony, to hear how the Lord is working in Latvia and around the world, just to fellowship with one another and to worship the Lord together. Happening in the next Sunday after that, December 12th, is our Celebrate Christmas Together. This is an idea that started out kind of as a ministry just to children and to young families in our area, but it's really evolved into more than that. And so we encourage you as a church family to come to participate. It'll be December 12th at 5 o'clock. We're going to have a lot of traditional things, stringing popcorn, decorating cookies, all those kinds of things. We encourage you to be here for that. Invite your friends, your family. Invite everybody. It's going to be in the NPR. It's going to be a lot of fun together. You also notice a couple other kids' activities happening in your bulletin. I encourage you to look through that. If you have any questions, please feel free to talk to me, to Terry, or any of the church staff. We'd love to help you out. This morning, our call to worship is a little bit different. We are entering into a time of Advent, and so I want to just briefly talk about what Advent is, and then I'm going to ask the young family in our church to do the reading for us and also open us in prayer. So just in general, during the month of December and today in November, actually, I'm about to get carried away, and I know Brother Jim does not want to do the next part. I need to recognize our canned food drive, because something happened yesterday. I'm not going to make Brother Jim talk about it. I will say, just for my dad, who graduated from Baylor, OSU Baylor in the Big 12 championship, so he'll be proud of that. But our canned food drive, this one's important. So we had OSU 272 cans, but that's right, that's good. Oklahoma had 371. So, yeah, and again, we're thankful for that. That canned food will be used here in our church to families in need and to give to those that need some of it. But turning our attention back to Advent and the things that are happening. During the month of December, we'll celebrate Advent. And Advent is symbolizes the present situation of the church in these last days. In the same way that the God's people, the Israelites, would look back to God's gracious actions on their behalf and bringing them out of Egypt and making covenants with them, the church now is once again calling God to act as we long for his return. As we look back at Jesus' birth, we remember why Jesus came, what he accomplished for us. And so we celebrate that. But at the same time, we look forward to his return again. So this is a time, again, of worship that we long for him to come again. It's the Christmas hymn, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, perfectly represents the church's cry of Advent this season. The words simply say, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lowly exile here until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. And so while Israel would have sung the song in expectation of Christ's first coming, the church now sings in commemoration of that and also his coming once again. And so this morning, I've invited Dax and Sarah Everts. So if you guys want to go ahead and make your way up here to the stage. Dax and Sarah have been involved in our church for a while now. I don't know how long. But they also have their three children, Delaney, Declan, and baby Dia. So I've asked them to read scripture for us and also to open us in a word of prayer. So I'm going to hand it over to them.
The first candle, which is purple, symbolizes hope. It is sometimes called the prophecy candle in remembrance of the prophets, especially Isaiah, who foretold the birth of Christ. It represents the expectation felt in anticipation of the coming Messiah.
Our scripture is Isaiah 9, 2, verse 2, 6, and 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us, a child is born. To us, a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness and of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign in David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice, righteousness, from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Okay, Delaney. As we approach Christmas and the celebration of our Savior, we celebrate the hope of salvation and the eternal life found in Christ.
Thank you for bearing with us, folks. Let's all pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for all your wonderful blessings, chief among them, your Son, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. May his light shine through us into our communities, into our church, into our families, and may the Holy Spirit bless those around us who need to see you, Lord, with sight of who you are. Bring our church body together, unified under you, Christ, and let us, as we look back to what wonderful thing you did 2,000 years ago, let us also look forward to your reign and your kingdom on this earth. And to you, all the honor and the glory. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's all stand together as we begin.
I better do this, don't I? It's good to be able to welcome you today. I couldn't decide which mic I wanted to use there. Appreciate you being here today in our service. Thank you for you visiting. For those of you who are visiting for the first time, we ask that you take one of our guest registration cards. Please fill it out, place it when the offering plate is passed so that we might have a record of your visit. And truly, we are grateful that you've chosen to be here the Sunday after Thanksgiving. I hope that everybody had a great time with their family and friends, and good to be back and be in worship together as a church family. I would like to mention some prayer requests this morning. You do have a prayer list in front of you that I always encourage you to to look at and help each week. You may not know everybody that is on there, but God knows them, and encourage you to remember them in your prayers. There are a couple of prayer requests that I want to mention. I mentioned this one last week. This is James and Deborah Miller's son-in-law, Randy Foster. We want to remember him this morning. Also on the prayer list today, Rick Scott, who is Vernon Scott's brother. He texted me this morning. His brother is on a ventilator, and they've not been able to wean him off yet. So he asked specifically for prayer for his lungs. So remember Rick Scott, if you would, this morning. We want to continue to pray for Kim Converse. He has been in Mercy Hospital, has not been doing just real well, and so ask that you remember him this morning. Also, Velma Geis, who is in rehab in Grand Villa. Our church janitor, Bo Jeffries, and his wife, Becky, both have come down with COVID this last week, so we want to remember them as they recuperate from that. Let's remember Pat Griffith's brother-in-law and sister, Jerry and Judy Lloyd. Let's remember that situation. Stephanie Plummer, we want to pray for today. And then some of our regular church family that we've had on the prayer list, Roger Glenn today, we want to remember. Also, May Baker, I think I saw her come in. Hey, May, good to see you today. We want to continue to remember Onita Berry, Helen Bolton, Jerry Brixey. Good to see Jerry with us here today. Alan Bruns. Alan is probably watching via Facebook Live. We want to remember Alan in our prayers. Robert and Ivy Castleman this morning. Mark Clark, the Double D's, Michael and Beverly. Jean Grounds, also Tina Henry. We want to continue to pray for Tina. And then Gary Keys, the Schilt family, who are missionaries in Malawi, and Sydney Shaw, Max Wallace, and Tony Zenai this morning. Speaking of the foreign missionaries, we will be praying for our week of prayer for international missions. We will be showing some videos of that, but this is Lottie Moon Christmas time. If you've ever been in a Southern Baptist church, you know what that is around December. Every bit of money that is given to Lottie Moon goes directly to the mission field. It does not pay for salaries for our missionaries. They are taken care of through the cooperative program that we do, that each church, as Southern Baptist churches all across America, cooperate together. But the Lottie Moon Christmas offering goes to fund special projects right on the field, wherever these missionaries may be. So I want to encourage you to be praying about that. Maybe you've never given to Lottie Moon, but you do believe in international missions. You do believe that God's word should be proclaimed throughout the world, and that is our responsibility. So let me encourage you to be praying about that today. So when we think of the Schilt family, they are International Mission Board missionaries, and we support them obviously as well. Our International Mission Banquet that we're going to have next Sunday night is also an event that we use to encourage us in the area of missions as well. So we want to be thinking about those things. So let's remember these. Let's also remember Sandy Lemons. We've been praying for her. She's on the back of our prayer list, and ask that you be with her today. So let's bow for a word of prayer together. Ask the Lord to be with us, and that His Holy Spirit would be in this place. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, Lord, and we ask, Father, that you would cleanse us, that you would make us whole, that you would prepare us for worship today. Father, we've already sung Jesus Messiah, the Christ. Lord, we're going to be talking about your special birth today in our service. Thank you that we've already lit an Advent candle, and Lord, we're thinking about this special time of the year. We just have come off of Thanksgiving, and Lord, we truly are grateful for that which you've done for us. Now, Father, we want to focus our attention on your son's birth. And so, Father, today, would you help us? Would you move everything out of the way that would be a hindrance to keeping us from worshiping you today? Father, we want to worship you in spirit and in truth. We ask, Lord, that you minister to each and every family, each and every person here today. Lord, in this large group, there is at least one person who has never admitted that they are a sinner and that they have never trusted in Christ and his salvation that he gives. Father, would you today help them? Would you convict them? And would you move them to the cross through that saving, wonderful message, the fact that the name Jesus means Jesus saves. Father, today would you be with those of us who are believers? Help us to be living completely, totally sold out lives to you. And Father, I pray today that we would acknowledge that, Lord, you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We truly desire to worship you today. Father, forgive us of sin. Again, cleanse us, make us pure, ready to receive whatever you have for us here today. And Lord, when it's all said and done, may we be as the psalmist. It has been good to be in the house of the Lord. So, Father, we love you and we thank you. And we pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I'd like to reiterate something that Daniel mentioned earlier. Next Sunday is our adult Christmas cantata. And we appreciate you all coming out and supporting us in that. And it's called The Most Wonderful Time of the Year. And yes, that song is in it. So you all can, there'll be plenty to sing along with. So again, that'll be during the next week's Sunday morning service. Well, let's continue in our singing. Your name is a strong and mighty tower.
Strong and mighty tower, your name is a shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, cause nothing has the power to save but your name. His mercy is more. lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood 'neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Praise the Lord, sing it out.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, through every morn, our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn, our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Our sins, they are many.
Let's stand together as we sing this last song.
I will try.
bow together for prayer as our ushers come forward to take this morning's offering. Father, we thank you that you do promise to reign with us and be with us. Father, we thank you for your advent here on earth. Lord, as we begin to celebrate this last Sunday in November and all through December, Lord, we just thank you for being our Emmanuel, our God with us. Lord, I pray that you'll take this offering now and bless it to further your kingdom. Bless Brother Jim as he comes and gives the message this morning, and may it all be done for your glory. In your name we pray. Amen.
We do have some talented musicians here at our church, and I appreciate June and the rest of them. The folks that come here at about 8:15 to 8:30 every Sunday morning to make sure that we do worship. And so when you get a chance and you see them from time to time, thank them for their willingness, because they help us to facilitate worship. And it is a great opportunity to be able to come together corporately and worship. We need private worship, but we need public worship as well. And so we appreciate them very much. If I was given Truth Serum today, I would say that I'm grateful for those of you who are involved in the can drive. But I would have rather OSU won the can drive than the football game. I'm just being very honest with you. But grateful for all of you who did help us with the can drive, and we will be using that food to help people as they come in to our church facilities during the week. A lot of times you do not know. Terry, Brother Thomas, myself, and Brother Daniel have opportunities to minister to people in the church's name. But you are a part of that because you helped give and your support in many different ways. We are able to be the hands and feet of Jesus during the week. So thank you for your generosity in many different ways. I am going to, we finished John chapter 10 last week. So what I want to do for the next few Sundays is to focus on some messages dealing with Christmas. So I'd like for you to turn to Luke chapter 2, the Gospel of Luke. And we are going to focus in on Christ's unequaled birth. Luke chapter 2, we're going to basically be looking at verses 1 through 7. I will use passages in Luke chapter 1 and on further in chapter 2. And this is where we will be for the next several weeks. So I hope that you will listen and be a part of this. One of my favorite preachers, he's gone on to be with the Lord, Dr. Adrian Rogers, pastor of Bellevue Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee. Had the privilege of hearing Dr. Rogers on several different occasions, personally, in person. Was always grateful to listen to him with Loveworth Finding Ministries. If by chance I didn't show up on a Sunday morning, which was very rare, but I remember one particular Sunday when I was dealing with gout and wasn't able to preach, I listened to Dr. Rogers one Sunday morning. This was before Facebook Live and some of that stuff that we have now. But Dr. Rogers has always had some interesting stories. And this past week, for the first time, I don't think I had realized this, but Dr. Rogers had an opportunity to witness to Muhammad Ali before one of his fights. Now, this had to be many years ago. And but as God would have it, he arranged a meeting in a small room before one of his fights, and they were talking about Jesus Christ. And Dr. Rogers was able to have prayer in his heart as he was going to witness to Muhammad Ali. And of course, Muhammad Ali had been had embraced the Islamic faith, and so Dr. Rogers had studied the faith, and so he was able to be knowledgeable of his particular faith that Muhammad Ali had embraced at that time. And so they were talking back and forth, and he challenged Dr. Rogers with this question. He said, "You say that Jesus Christ is the Son of God because he was born of a virgin. He didn't have an earthly father." And then he said to Dr. Rogers, "Adam didn't have a father or a mother. Wouldn't that make Adam more of a son of God than Jesus?" Dr. Rogers looked at him and said, "Champ, I want you to understand this. Jesus was not the Son of God because he was born of a virgin. He was born of a virgin because he was the Son of God." And folks, that is true. That is a very true statement. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, through God's providence, through his plan, sent his Son Jesus Christ to come here to this earth. And we're going to look at Christ's unequal birth this morning. I know you know this passage of Scripture, but please allow God's Word to speak to your heart today. Just because you're familiar with the story, don't miss some things that are here, because even I, as a pastor, there are things that come out. There are things in the text. There are truths in the text that sometimes it's just like they jump out of the page toward us. And so I want you to look at that today. I'm going to begin reading in Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. We're going to read down through verse, actually I'm going to read down a little bit further than verse 7, but you follow with me as I read. I'm reading from the New American Standard. And here is what the word of the Lord says, Luke chapter 2. Now in those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that a census be taken of all the inhabited earth. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone was on his way to register for the census, each to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, in order to register along with Mary, who was engaged to him and was with child. While they were there, the days were completed for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him in cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. May God bless the reading of his word today. Let's bow and ask the Lord to be with us here this morning. Father, Lord, this is your gospel, Luke's gospel. And Father, I believe in Luke we see an expanded version of the incarnation of Jesus Christ. We see things that happened before, and then obviously we see what we've just read in the text about the census and about Joseph and Mary traveling. Lord, her being with child, and Lord, this is a special birth. This is an unequal birth. And so, Father, would you help us today to understand the truth that is there? Father, our religion, our faith, is based on this particular passage of Scripture and what is taught there. And so, Lord, I pray today that you would help us to understand. Lord, there may be some individuals here in this service today that are not able to comprehend the virgin birth. I pray, Lord, that by the end of the service, that you through faith, through your power and your revelation, that you would show them just how important this doctrine is and how it helps us and how we can understand salvation through it. Lord Jesus, speak to our hearts today and help us, Lord, to comprehend, and then, Lord, help us to live in such a way that it would be pleasing to you. And we give you praise, for we ask it in your Son's blessed name. Amen. As we look at this particular passage of Scripture, we're going to look at some different things. Before we do, I want to read to you from the Baptist Faith and Message. It is our statement of faith. Now, we believe that the Word of God is our belief system. The Word of God is authoritative. All Scripture is inspired by God. It's profitable for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, and those types of things. But we believe that the Baptist Faith and Message, which is based on Scripture, gives us some insight into to doctrine. So let me just share with you the particular statement concerning God the Son. Here's what it says. Christ is the eternal Son of God. In his incarnation as Jesus Christ, he was conceived of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. Jesus perfectly revealed and did the will of the Father, having upon himself human nature with its demands and necessities, and identifying himself completely with mankind, yet without sin. He honored the divine law by his personal obedience, and in his substitutionary death on the cross, he made provision for the redemption of men from sin. He was raised from the dead with a glorified body and appeared to his disciples as the person who was with them before his crucifixion. He ascended into heaven and is now exalted at the right hand of God, where he is the one mediator, fully God, fully man, in whose person is effected the reconciliation between God and man. He will return in power and glory to judge the world and to consummate his redemptive mission. He now dwells in all believers as the living and ever-present Lord. Now within that statement, which is a statement of faith in what we believe, it says there at the first that he was conceived of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. I believe that the birth of Christ is supernatural, like no other birth. And folks, we need to understand some more about this today. And so the first thing that I want you to understand about Christ's unequal birth is the mystery of Christ's birth. To understand the mystery, we've got to go back a little bit in Scripture. Turn there, you're in chapter 2. Just turn a page over backwards to Luke chapter 1 and look at verse 28. And I want you to hear, and I'm so grateful that Luke was able to give this to us. Because all the Gospels are different and unique, but this one, Luke gives us some really good reference here. In verse 28 of chapter 1, here's what he says. And coming in, he said to her, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was very perplexed at this statement and kept pondering what kind of salutation this was. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" Now, literally in the Greek text, it says, "How can this be, since I have known no man?" And the word "know" there means to know in an intimate sexual way. So the New American Standard translates it there, "How can this be since I am a virgin?" And clearly she was a virgin, okay? The angel answered there in verse 35 and said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God. And behold, even your relative Elizabeth also conceived a son in her old age, and she who was called barren is now in her sixth month." And notice verse 37, "For nothing will be impossible with God." Folks, we need to understand that today. We need to understand that in a moment, nothing is impossible. If you have difficulty with the phrase today, then you've got problems with the virgin birth. But our God can truly do all things. And we're talking here about the mystery of Christ's birth. And by the way, you don't have to understand the virgin birth for it to be valid. I don't know that I can give you a formula for it. Let me give you something to kind of help you a little bit today. Have you ever wondered how a brown cow that eats green grass produces white milk? I want an answer. Anybody got one? I can't figure that one out. I just know that when I used to milk cows, and I used to, folks, I'm not telling a fairy tale here. I used to milk a couple of cows before my brother went off to Votech when I was in junior high and high school. We had two milk cows, two Jersey cows. So I know where the milk comes from, and I used to help get it in the pail, and we brought it to the house, and we would strain the cream from the milk, and we drank cow's milk right from the cow. And we gave it green grass, and it was a brown cow, and it gave white milk. By the way, people, it doesn't come out chocolate either. Whoops, I just got in trouble for that one. Now, you don't understand the virgin birth? I don't understand it either. I can't explain it all to you, but folks, the Bible teaches it. In fact, you can see within this passage here in chapter 1, you can see all of the parts of the Trinity. You see God the Father, the God of the Most High. You see the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will overshadow you. And then you see the Son of God who comes down and is going to become man through that little baby boy. You see, God's in all of this here, folks. He knew exactly what needed to happen. And if you can't wrap your brain around it, you know, there's just going to be some things that you don't understand. I don't understand how a car engine works. Some of you do. I don't know all the details. I just know that if I put the key in the ignition and start it, and hopefully it starts, then I'm going to drive it down the road. But folks, I am not going to sit on the side of the road until I figure out how a car works. So I ask that you not set aside today and say, well, I can't understand the virgin birth. Folks, with God, all things are possible. He has chosen to do it this way. If you cannot wrap your brain around the virgin birth, then maybe your God is too small today. I think we see the mystery of Christ's birth. I want you to listen to a passage in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. It says, by common confession, great is the mystery of godliness. He who was revealed in the flesh was vindicated in the spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world. There it talks about Christ's incarnation. God becoming man. Please understand today, we don't believe that Jesus Christ is half God and half man. He is fully divine. He is fully human. He is the God-man. And that, my friend, is the mystery of Christ's birth. But we're not going to stop there. We're going to go on further. Notice the second point. Notice the ministry of Christ's birth. You see, the purpose or ministry of Christ's birth can be found in the passage that I didn't go ahead and read here in chapter 2. Look at beginning in verse 8 down through verse 11. In the same region there were many shepherds staying on in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Right there, folks, we see the ministry of Christ's birth. He is the Savior. Jesus came to this earth to be the God-man. He was born of a virgin so that he could be the Savior of mankind. He was perfect in every way, but he was also divine. He knew no sin, so that he could become sin on our behalf when he went to the cross. The sins of the world were put on Jesus Christ at the cross. But folks, we have to begin at the manger in Bethlehem. That's the gospel message. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Listen to what Matthew, how he describes it in Matthew chapter 1. He says, and she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. The word Jesus is the Greek word for the Hebrew word Joshua, and it means Yahweh saves. It's a statement. Folks, those names in the Old Testament and the New Testament meant something. When a name was put upon a person, this came from God himself. This came from the angels. You are going to have a child. You're going to have a baby boy. You are to name his name Jesus. And folks, that is the ministry of Christ's birth. You know, all of us, when we think about it, all of us here today are sinners. There's not a person here today who could say, well, you know, Brother Jim, I really don't think I've sinned. I think I'm a pretty good person. Now, there may be some individuals out there today that act like that and think that, but they're fooling themselves. Let's be honest today, folks. We've all blown it, haven't we? We've messed up. Some of you messed up last night watching TV. I think I did too. But anyway, and that's foolish too, anyway. But the thing about it is that we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, because Romans tells us that. It also tells us in Romans 6:23 that the wages of sin is death, separation from God. My friend, if you don't do something about your sin problem, and every one of us does have a sin problem, if you don't do something about your sin problem and you die, you will be eternally separated from God. No second chances. I don't care what anybody teaches. There is no second chance. Once there is death, and folks, all of us are going to die unless Jesus comes back. Now, if Jesus comes back before you and I die, praise God, the dead in Christ are going to rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be changed in the twinkling of an eye, and we will get to be in the air with the Lord, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. I'm all for that. But my friend, if you don't do something, the payment for your sins, and they're your sins, you can't blame them on your parents. You can't blame them on the way that you were raised. You can't blame them on society today. You can't blame them on the environment. You can't blame it on anybody else. Folks, one of these days, it's going to be you, you and alone, standing before God. For the wages of sin is death. But I'm glad that verse didn't stop there. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. There he is. There's our gift. The gift that keeps on giving. The gift that we are going to celebrate once again this year. Folks, don't ever get tired of the fact that Jesus Christ is God's gift to mankind. That if it wasn't for that gift, you and I would be in a hopeless state. But he doesn't stop there. But God, in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I'm so grateful for that verse. We were sinners. We are sinners. But God demonstrates his love. He didn't just say, I love you. He proved it with the giving of his son, that great sacrificial gift. And my friend, God decided to use a manger. That's pretty good effects, by the way, there. God decided to use a manger to bring us to the point that ultimately we're going to go to the cross. And folks, salvation message begins with a virgin birth. I can't explain it, but I can accept it by faith. If God, listen, it goes back to Genesis 1. If you believe that God created the heavens and the earth, folks, God can intervene into history and decide to give us a virgin with child. That's not beyond what God can do. The Roman road, also need to mention Romans 10:9-10, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus the Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made, resulting in salvation. And then he sums it all up in verse 13 of Romans 10, when he says, for whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever. That means you. That means me. Have you ever made salvation personal in your life? It's wonderful because of the special birth. Jesus' birth. We see the mystery of it. We see the ministry of it. And folks, it's interesting. You know, I would qualify Mary's predicament situation as a crisis pregnancy. Her and Joseph were not married yet. And I'll guarantee there was tongues wagging in the town as she got bigger and bigger. But it's interesting that people today would justify and say, you know what? Mary, you're behind the eight ball. Mary, you don't understand. This is a crisis pregnancy. This is a matter of choice. You need to choose to end that pregnancy. Interesting, though, those that claim choice. The unborn child has distinct DNA, blood type that is different from the mom, separate heartbeat, organs, hands, and feet. And yet there were people today would say that situation qualifies for Mary to have an abortion. I'm grateful that in that day and time, that Mary chose to listen to the angel of the Lord, and that she, by obedience, said, you know what? I can't see everything out in front of me. I don't understand what's going on, but I trust my Lord. And folks, because of that, we have the perfect, spotless Lamb of God. You see, instead of listening to the world, she listened to the Lord. And because Jesus is the Savior of the world, that is His ministry. Jesus, Yahweh, saves. But there's one final point. Not only the mystery of Christ's birth, not only the ministry of His birth, but notice the majesty of Christ's birth. And you got to go back again, once again, go back to chapter 1 for just a minute. And let you look at verse 30, the angel speaking to her again. Chapter 1, verse 30, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." We just sang about it. "And he shall reign forever and ever." He comes the first time, folks, as Savior, seeking those who are lost. Do you find yourself in that situation today? Do you find yourself today on the other side of salvation? Do you find yourself today, you've tried to figure it out, you've tried to be a good person, you have felt like that maybe your parents, because they were Christians or because they followed God, that it just came natural to you? My friend, you will have to deal with that on your own. You will have to deal with the subject of salvation. These verses clearly teach that Jesus is the promised child and the one who comes to save. Jesus is God in human flesh. I've shared this story with you before, but it's worth repeating. There's a story about a little boy who woke up in the middle of the night. It was a violent thunderstorm, probably here in Oklahoma somewhere. He was frightened by the thunder and lightning, and he cried out for his mother. She reassured him in the other room and told him never to be afraid of the dark or the storms, because God was right there with him. In a few moments, after some more thunder claps, he cried out again, and this time his mother came to his side and reminded the youngster of the earlier assurance that God was with him in the storm. And I want you to listen to what he said. He said, "I know," said the little boy, "but I want someone with skin on." Well, guess what? God did it. He gave us someone with skin. Jesus Christ, God's Son, became man. He lived on this earth. Folks, it's a proven fact. He lived on this earth. He was perfect. He performed miracles. He obeyed His Heavenly Father. He came here with a purpose of glorifying God. He came here for a purpose of taking on the sins of the world. His name is Jesus. Yahweh saves. Salvation has come from a manger, through a manger in Bethlehem. He is the earthly child of a heavenly father and the heavenly child of an earthly mother. The little baby lying in a manger, wrapped in swaddling clothes, with his dimpled feet touching the straw, is the mighty God of Genesis chapter 1. Do you believe that? Pay attention to how John describes it. In John chapter 1, the very first part of John's gospel, you need to understand this today. John starts out just like Genesis chapter 1 does, but in a little bit different flavor. Let me read just a little bit of John 1 for you this morning. It says this: In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Then you go down to verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw His glory, glory as to the only begotten from the Father, that is full of grace and truth. Oh, my friend, let me tell you something. God coming down to earth to take on flesh. Philippians tells us that He did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped. He was willing to empty Himself. The Son of God, sitting at the right hand of the Father, was willing to forego all of that and come down and become human flesh. And folks, the reason why? So that you and I might have life and have it more abundantly. My friend, recognize the mystery of Christ's birth. Remember the ministry of Christ's birth, and then rejoice in the majesty of Christ's birth. Let me share this with you and I close. John Robert Oppenheimer said this one day. He said, the best way to send an idea is to wrap it up in a person. The theological word for all of this is incarnation, meaning in the flesh. Jesus was the incarnation of God. Jesus was the way that God sent His idea to humanity. There was and is no better way. One of the early church fathers, whose name was Ignatius, explained that by the incarnation, God broke His silence. Less scholarly is an explanation made by a little girl one day at church. She said this. Some people couldn't hear God's inside whisper, so He sent Jesus to tell them out loud. Folks, that's exactly what Jesus did. That's exactly what the Heavenly Father did. Do you realize today that He loves you so much that He's willing to send His Son as a gift for you and me? Do you realize today that you don't have to live in your sins? Do you realize today you don't have to be condemned forever in a hell eternal, separated from God? You don't have to live that way. My friend, you can come to Christ today and you can experience heaven here on earth by living for Jesus Christ. And then one of these days, you will experience heaven for sure. Heaven that is real. Folks, that is a great thing. That is Christ's unequaled birth. He came because He loves you and me. The question this morning, will you love Him in return? I believe, as you see there on the conclusion, Christ's cradle will rock the world. Some will accept it. Unfortunately, many will reject it. How about you? I want us to bow our heads in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, this morning, we ask you, Lord, there are some today who would say that the virgin birth is not that important. Science, it doesn't fit the realm of reason. Scientists today and those who are scoffers today mock us because we believe in the virgin birth. But thank you, God, for sending your son Jesus. It wasn't no ordinary birth. It was supernatural. And God, I can't explain it all today. Even as someone who has trusted in you some 40-some years ago. But Lord, I believe you. I believe Genesis 1:1. I believe John 1:1. I believe John 1:14, where it says the Word became flesh. John was speaking of Jesus there in John 1. You've dwelt among us. You went to the cross to die for our sins. Thank you for the gift. We can't earn it today. We can't live good enough. We can't pay enough money for it. We can't be a part of a prestigious family to get in. But we can admit that we're a sinner today. And we can repent of those sins and we can ask Christ to come and save us. Because his desire is to save. Jesus saves. Lord, let it happen again today. If there's someone here today who's struggling with whether they know Christ or not, Lord, help them to figure it out today. You show them where they're at. And if they don't know you today, help them to know you. And if we claim to know you today, then, Lord, we should be living for you. Help us to do so today. In Christ alone is where we should stand today. I pray it be every person's heart and testimony today. Lord, thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Would you stand to your feet as we sing this hymn of invitation? Brother Matt leads us in Christ alone. You come as we sing. There's an altar here. If you need to come to Christ, you come on this morning. Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise offering. Amen. God bless you today for being here. Remember the activities, especially tomorrow. If you have time and have some free time, come help us decorate here at the church, and we would appreciate that. Now, as good Baptists, we will feed you if you come. Okay? So just want to remind you of that, okay? Remember the activities for the week. We start back up on our Wednesday night Bible study and our regular family times together, teen kid, youth, and all of that. So remember that as well. Remember, keep the bulletin around. It helps you know what's going on, all right? Thank you for being here, especially those of you who are visiting. Brother Matt, close us with our song, please.
As we go, may your spirit come.